here lives in persistent fear of an Indian attack, whether it's justified or not.
By 1832, the area we know as Wisconsin was still more than a decade away from statehood and technically part of the Michigan Territory. Fewer than 4,000 white settlers lived here, and the U.S. government had begun moving native tribes into common areas known as reservations. Most, but definitely not all, of those natives cooperated.
Blackhawk seems very much committed to not bending to the will of the American.
Blackhawk is a war leader of the Sauk Nation who refuses to accept what he considers a bogus treaty that surrendered their tribal homelands in northern Illinois. The Sauk have been gathered and moved to Iowa, but in 1832, Blackhawk leads about 150 warriors and a band of civilians across the Mississippi River to reoccupy their ancestral lands. He clashes there with Illinois militia troops who interpret his arrival as an invasion.
Blackhawk, now at war, actually sends his warriors out on the warpath, and they commit a number of depredations in northern Illinois and southern Wisconsin. But essentially, from the moment of that fight on, he's fleeing.
Blackhawk hopes to inspire a major Indian uprising. Instead, he and his band are on their own and outmatched. They move north along the Rock River, then west, passing by present-day Lake Mills. They cross the Madison Isthmus and spend the night in modern-day Middleton. Closely pursued by U.S. troops led by future Wisconsin Governor Henry Dodge, the natives continue west towards the Wisconsin River. Blackhawk plans to float the women and children in boats back to the safety of their camp in Iowa, but he is forced to fight first.
It's the only time in which a large element of the American army comes into contact with Blackhawk's main body in a manner that you could even call it a battle.
The Battle of Wisconsin Heights was fought here on a cool, rainy day in July, just off what is now Highway 78, south of Sauk City. Colonel Dodge and his men arrived first, and they're followed shortly after by General James Henry and hundreds of cavalry from that direction.
There's a firefight, muskets in those days, for about half an hour. Then Dodge leads a bayonet charge, killing and scattering what's left of Blackhawk's force. One U.S. soldier is killed, seven wounded.
It's a pitched engagement. All but one of the Kickapoo warriors, out of a contingent of nearly 100, dies in the Battle of Wisconsin Heights. Although Blackhawk's casualties are far, far more extensive than are those of the American troops, he succeeds in his mission, which is to cover the withdrawal of his non-combatants, to get them across the river. Once they're across the river, what he tries to do is to push most of his women and children and invalids down the river on canoes and rafts, hoping that when they get to Prairie du Chien, they'll be regarded as inoffensive and allowed to go home. And then he takes the rest of his force and cuts cross country to try to cross the Mississippi River further up.
The final confrontation of the Blackhawk War comes as the Sauk war leader and his band reach the Mississippi River, where the Bad Axe River empties into it north of Prairie du Chien. The Battle of Bad Axe was a massacre, as the natives were attacked from troops on land and from a boat on the river.
The Blackhawk War is responsible for erasing from Wisconsin the Indian country. The flood of white settlement into Wisconsin begins in the wake of the Blackhawk War.
By the end of the Blackhawk War in 1832, about 3,600 white settlers were living in the future Wisconsin. 10 years later, 10 times that many would be living here. The Blackhawk War also marked the last military battle to be fought in Wisconsin.